Thank you very much. I want to thank you, first of all, for inviting me. This was almost a year back that I was invited with a very specific subject, which you can see here. But before I start to talk about my subject, I would like to be politically correct. I want to point out that I have a conflict of interest, of course, being the CEO of the company that produces the device I'm talking about. I just want you to know this. But I also want to tell you why this is important for me, because for us it is equally important to know if our technologies work in an indication, but also to know if they do not work in an indication, because we want to be serious. We don't want to claim something that doesn't work. So if you do an RCT and we have the result that it doesn't work, we also publish it. And then we know the limitations of our technologies and our therapies. And I think this is part of being serious. We've even, in this moment, one PubMed listed a study that says that our therapy is not efficient and that there are other therapies that are more efficient. Okay, this for conflict of interest. All right, my subject today is, I was asked to talk about the pain alleviating effects of deep oscillation, which is a technology that is known around the world, and in UK it is getting known more and more because of our partners Physiopod. All right. What I want to structure my talk. First of all, I would like to give you a small introduction on the modality deep oscillation. Then I would give you a small overview over the studies that exist. Before I will turn to the actual subject, which is pain reduction through by deep oscillation. So all of you know this picture. Your children have an air balloon and you bring it in the vicinity of your hair and suddenly your hair goes up and is attracted to the balloon. This is basically the same, or it is one element that we use in deep oscillation. It's called electrostatic attraction. So deep oscillation is used, uses electrostatic attraction, which we produce with the help of a machine that is connected to a contact that the patient holds in his hand, as you see here on this picture. And the second contact that is connected to the machine is either a hand applicator or it is a gloved hand. And the hand applicator and the glove have the same function. They are in between the hand or the applicator here. They have the characteristics of a semiconductor. So what do we do now? We apply a voltage to this circuit, and what happens? Due to this device, we create an electrostatic force, and this electrostatic force attracts the tissue to the applicator or to the gloved hand. Now, we are not interested of having the balloon thing and have the tissue attracted without relieving it. So we put the voltage only for a certain time, then we switch it off. Then we do one more thing to get this electrostatic force even stronger. We discharge after this voltage impulse. We discharge the entire system, make a pause, and then restart another impulse into the other direction. So then we do a pause again and have the next on phase. So this way we cause an intermittent electrostatic field. This can be varied between 5 and 250 times per second, so 5 to 250 hertz. If we start now to move the applicator or the gloved hand, friction gets involved. And what happens then as a result out of this is that the tissue starts to vibrate. And depending on the frequency we select, this can be a mechanically stronger action with a low frequency, with a pumping effect, or this can be an effect that is perceived more superficially. It is not superficial, but it's more gentle and is more suited for acute pain conditions, open wounds, and so on. So what was shown in the meantime also is that deep oscillation, these resonant vibrations have a deep acting effect. And it has been measured by ultrasound that the effect goes as deep as 8 centimeters into the tissue. This is something you can, for example, also experience very easily. Take a stethoscope, treat a patient on the thorax, listen with the stethoscope on the back, and you will hear that the entire thorax is vibrating. I have a video. This is a video where a professor in Costa Rica, it is also available in the internet on our website, where this professor simultaneously uses ultrasound, imaging ultrasound, and does deep oscillation on a seroma in the knee area. And you can see in this video the effect of deep oscillation on the seroma, how it shifts in waves when the treatment is applied. There is a second video which I want to use to show you this property of deep oscillation, because it is very gentle, it is non-invasive, it is non-traumatic. And the difference, it is an electromechanical therapy, but the difference from externally applied mechanical therapies, it is produced in the tissue itself. It is the tissue itself that starts to oscillate, and this makes it extremely gentle. And this makes it suitable and motivated therapists already very, very early to use it in acute pain conditions, where you usually even don't touch with hands maybe, like whiplash injuries, but also in the area of open wounds. So what we see in this video is a deep oscillation treatment that is done in a plastic surgery clinic in Santiago de Chile, who have even published already some scientific papers on this application, and they are working on a breast construction. And the interesting thing is the very early moment of applying this therapy, they use it after the surgery in the waking up room. They basically do is they work in the sense of or in the direction of manual lymphatic drainage very gently here. And this is not the only example. This therapy was already applied in Germany in several clinics in the year 1991 after mastectomy, and I've seen many times patients on the first day post-surgery with the drainage inside the surgery area being treated with deep oscillation and seeing in the drainage how the liquid runs into the drainage promoted by or enhanced by the deep oscillation. I want to go shortly through the clinical effects that were proven in RCTs and clinical studies up to now for deep oscillation. We've seen in vitro studies, but also in human studies, an anti-inflammatory effect, especially the interleukin 8, which is a very prominent pro-inflammative cytokine. It has been shown in several studies that it reduces secondary and primary lymphedema, and that it has a reducing edema element of lipedema. This is something that was shown in the UK. We'll see that later. It was shown that deep oscillation has a very strong muscular relaxation and decongestion effect, which leads to a better nutrition of this area, but it also has a functional improvement and improved range of motion as a consequence. One reason why deep oscillation is by therapists like to use deep oscillation in combination with MLD is that deep oscillation has an effect on fibrotic processes. This can be the case in light fibrosis that have already installed, but it has also very strong preventional effect for fibrotic processes. There are many cases of wound healing that were treated by deep oscillation, especially there is one study on secondary degree burns. There's also one clinic in the UK that is using it already. But also we have seen really stunning cases already of people with secondary wound healing, people that had already been abandoned by clinics and that trying everything for themselves ended up with us in the end. You can find these studies and photo documentation either in the internet or you can ask us, we can send you if you're interested. Recently, several studies have been published or are under publication in the sports field showing that deep oscillation accelerates recovery after physical workout, with the results that sportsmen can faster get back to normal training or recover faster between tournaments. And this concerns on the one hand blood parameters, but on the other hand also the muscle force that is stronger and this has been shown in different works now, after DPOS deposylation in comparison to control groups. And it is logical because intensive physical workout is nothing but a micro trauma, and then we're again in the trauma area. There are several publications on decongestional and functional improvement effects in obstructive pulmonary diseases, for example in COPD, but also in children with cystic fibrosis and other areas. There is a number of studies that are available in PubMed about depostulation. We can send you the list if you're interested. And there is an uncountable number of other publications that can partly be found in the internet or also be asked from us. There is also one publication already in the UK that can be found in the ResearchGate. And this study actually confirmed something that we already had seen in German studies, that depostulation combined with manual lymphatic drainage has a significantly greater reduction in levels of edema in lymphedema and in lipedema than treated with manual lymphatic drainage alone. So let's turn back to the actual subject that you were asking, which is our pain alleviation effects of depostulation. Here we have the area of traumatic pain, which can be caused by surgery, especially in mastectomy, but which can be any other kind of mechanical trauma, where we, in sports for example, where we have several RCTs showing a pain relieving effect. Recently, one paper has been published on the fibrocystic breast disease in a US journal, very high impact, and there is one paper on pain reduction in the fibromyalgia syndrome. Now we go a little deeper into science. What you see here are pictures taken from ex vivo skin models, and what was examined here was the expression of capsaicin receptors on keratinocytes, and capsaicin receptors are one parameter that is being looked at in pain studies recently, or not recently, only for quite some time, and is given quite some importance. And what you can see here is that after two treatments, the number of cells expressing TRPV1 expressions are less in the intervention group than in the control group. So this shows that there is a pain relieving effect, but we must find out now how this is caused. In the same study, they were checking and quantifying the surface of dilated dermal capillaries and found that depostulation has the effect of a moderate vasoconstriction. This is a very important aspect for edema formation and edema control. So now I bring you into an edema we have in this animation. You have an edema that has formed in the interstitial area. And now comes depostulation, and due to the mechanical effect, it helps to dissolve, it helps to disintegrate, it helps to mix up edema components like dead cells or cell debris and many other things. And due to the mixing up and the distribution, we increase the surface in terms of numbers of lymphatic vessels that can take up this liquid and contents. So we increase the surface for resorption. And by this mechanical action of depostulation, we most probably have an effect on the initial lymph vessels and on primary lymph collectors, which, as you know, are epithelium plates that are laid over each other, and they are connected through these anchoring filaments to higher levels of the tissue. And by this mechanical action, we think that there is a mechanical effect on these anchoring filaments, which leads to an action on the epithelia plates and to an opening of the gaps of the primary lymphary vessels, and this way promoting the interstitial drainage.
You have the fluid in the interstitium, and you say it activates it, so it spreads it out more, so it's not in a lump.
Exactly.
So in that way, it's increasing the volume, it's spreading out the volume, so then the lymphatic vessels are more able to take it in because it's thinned and stretched.
Not only because it's stretched, but also because we distribute it, get it so to more anastomosis, to more possible lymph vessels, initial lymph vessels that can take it up. And we believe that there is an effect on the lymph vessel itself to promote the opening of these gaps.
No,
but we are trying to understand why this therapy has a stronger effect with manual lymphatic drainage than without, and why it especially makes manual lymphatic drainage more efficient if indurations, edema, hematoma, seroma are concerned. So when we get back to our major subject, what could be the reasons for the strong pain-reducing effect of deep oscillation, then one mechanism could be deep oscillation by its mechanical action affects the gait control mechanism, which we know from electrotherapy, from TENS. And how is this possible? Recently, a lot of scientific papers have been published that concentrate on the action of physical agents on a cellular level. And several papers say today that you can exchange electrical pulses, stimuli, to mechanical ones. You can replace the one by the other as long as they are working in the same window. And they are doing some research in this moment very much on windows in terms of what frequencies do we use to provide these certain effects and what minimum intensities we need to use. So it is very likely that mechanical pulses could act in the same way as electrical stimuli do. Of course, what we saw in this animation, these dissolving effects and the distribution and the enhanced interstitial drainage also lead to a reduction of the noxious stimulus potential and reduces the tissue acidosis. And this would be an explanation why in treatment, after treatment of deep oscillation, the capsaicin receptors reduce. Because they are very sensitive to acidosis and to noxious potential of other kind. You can, for example, with pepper, you can, it's also called the pepper receptor. So another possible effect is our pain modulating effects. This is also something that has been shown in electrotherapy in the last years, that exact windows of electrical stimuli can provide cell reactions on receptors, but also trigger on this way cascades inside the cell. And this is called informational cell therapy, and there is there are a lot of papers to be found in on the databases. And it could also be inflammation-mediated effects. And this question we ask ourselves, especially when we look at the interleukin 8. So a very important factor for the pain relief is muscular relaxation. There are different theories that show how high muscular pressure, how hypertonicity and congestion, muscular congestion, are in a circulus viciosus for pain. And we certainly know that deep oscillation relaxes muscles, and there is a decongestion in the treated area. And logically, we reduce the ischemic conditions, so we bring better perfusion of the area by this treatment. And this is also an explanation why, for example, deep oscillation works in myogenesis or in fibromyalgia, because it evacuates, it relaxes, and this way allows new nutrients to come in to get a normal metabolism in the area. And of course, I mentioned this before, this moderate vasomodulating effect, which has an importance for edema formation. So I get already to summary. You can, of course, ask your questions if you want. Deep oscillation is an electromechanical modality. It is non-invasive, non-traumatic. This makes it suitable for application in very severe pain conditions, in open wounds, and in very early trauma, for example, on the first day after surgery, or in mechanical trauma, also on the first day after trauma. It is already being used thousands and thousands of times every day around the world. We have many references in Germany, for example, the Charité. For example, the Fodder Academy, in the meantime, recommends deep oscillation for manual lymphatic drainage if fibrotic processes are involved. And last but not least, we do not stop to investigate on this therapy on all levels, from in vitro through RCTs, because we are interested in getting more evidence basing for this therapy. And to close, I want to tell you a little story. This is a picture that was taken in Cuba 12 years ago. We were invited to take part in a tender for physical modalities, electrostimulators, ultrasound, lasers, and so on. And we did this, and we had to send demo devices over. It was for all polyclinics and hospitals of Cuba. And we also added a deep oscillation machine. And when it arrived there, they said, oh, we didn't order this, we don't need this. And we said, come on, try it. And we brought a therapist over and made a training course, also with maybe the same amount of people that are here, and explained it. And one doctor took the machine, took her to her polyclinic, and started to use it. And then happened something very lucky for us. In this clinic, the secretary of Fidel Castro was treated, and she had a lymphedema in the leg, and she couldn't walk. And she hadn't been able to walk for months. And this doctor started to work on her, and she got better after every treatment, and after 1 week she already walked out of the polyclinic, and she went to his boss and told him that she had seen a miracle, and this had been is very pleasant, she feels lighter and so on. And his boss then said, okay, I want to have this in all hospitals and all polyclinics. And this way we sold to Cuba in 2007 1,000 HiVermart devices. And when I go over there still, I was there last week, they are very happy, and they use it in many, many fields in the meantime. There are quite some studies coming from this country, or even from Cubans that have in the meantime left the country and doing research on this. And What I want to say with this is, I can talk a lot and you can listen to me, but the most efficient with this therapy is that you try it out. We have seen many therapists that were very reluctant, that say, I don't use modalities, I use only my hands. And after some time, they just tried it. And this is, I want to motivate you, if you're interested, try it, and then you will see the results. And if you don't have them, don't get it. But I've rarely seen people that have tried it and have not had results. Thank you very much for your attention.